So firstly, a very good evening to everyone present today. Here's giving a little introduction about Girl Up. So Girl Up is an initiative of the United Nations Foundation, working across a global community of partners to achieve gender equality worldwide. It is a global leadership development initiative, positioning girls to be leaders in the movement for gender equality. Since its launch in 2010, the initiative has funded UN programs that promote the health, safety, education, and leadership of girls in developing countries and build a community of 700,000 passionate advocates. Our youth leaders, representing more than 3,000 Girl Up clubs, are in over 100 countries, and they are standing up, speaking up, and rising up to support the hardest to reach girls living in areas where it is extremely hard to reach them. Now, giving a little introduction to our guest today, ma'am, Dr. Nirmal Jindal. She is the principal of Satyavati College, Delhi University. She has been a senior associate professor in the Department of Political Science, Satyavati College, Delhi University, for more than two decades. She has done extensive research in the field of international relations and has published three books and several articles on issues of nuclear strategies, Indo-Pakistan conflict on Kashmir, changing dimensions of security, globalization, and relevance of M.K. Gandhi in the contemporary world. She is also interested and is getting associated with any of the research projects related to security issues, including environment security. Her upcoming book is on international relations from the Indian perspective, and she has recently delivered a dynamic talk on democracy in Afghanistan at Ramanujan College. Thank you, ma'am, for joining us today, and we really look forward to a lively discussion. Now, I would like to hand it over to Aditi to take the session forward.
Hello, everyone. Hello, ma'am. So I'll be telling you the questions one by one, and we'll then carry forward the discussion. So the first question is, we have all witnessed that women suffer the worst consequences in all situations of war. So how far do you think women are able to preserve their rights in Afghanistan? What is the status of education and employment for them?
Thank you, Aditi, for this question. Thank you very much for welcoming me to your platform. I'm very much delighted to be here. And recently, I'm promoted to professorship in the Department of Political Science at college level. And our book is already published on global politics, and the third one is in making. And because I've been a student and I've been reading and researching on international relations, so this topic is of special interest to me, and particularly because it concerns women. So this question that how war affects women, as you know that there are two perspectives. One perspective is that realists in international relations, they consider war as a political instrument to achieve political objectives. So they consider war, essential to achieve national interest. But so far, women are concerned. They reject this idea. They think that international relations is patriarchic. Because males think security in terms of power, they think in terms of war. That's why, they think that security is related to war. But women think that war always acts against women. It makes women insecure. If we look at from the historical perspective, because as you see that the society had been, the work domains had been divided between private and public domains, and women had been confined to the private, and they had been dependent on the male partners or the males in the families. So whenever there is war and they lose these male family members, whether they are their siblings, their father, husband, or anything, but the females have been suffering. So from that perspective, they think that there's women all over the world, they have this common concern that war should be rejected. It makes women insecure. Excuse me. So I think that so far this women are concerned, if you look at the history of India also at the time of partition, or you have heard about this Jauhar in Rajasthan, how women have been suffering. So one is that they used to lose their family members, and the secondly, they themselves used to be victim of violence, you know, physical violence in war. You know that even in the Western countries or in other countries historically, and now also if you look at Afghanistan has been, you know, in war, constant war, you know, for thousands of years, and particularly since 1979. If we look that when Russia moved into Afghanistan, since then, women have been suffering because there has been a war-like situation in Afghanistan. Earlier, Russia moved in Afghanistan and then it left. But then Taliban had been controlling and suppressing the rights of women. And then, you know, 2001, United States entered in Afghanistan. So constantly there had been, you know, problem in Afghanistan. So United States, after it entered in Afghanistan, it tried to introduce certain liberal democratic values, like tried to promote the rights of women, right to education, right to employment, but with certain restraints, certain constraints, certain limitations. Because there is cultural difference in this society. So within that cultural framework or within that social framework, they tried to bring in those reforms. After Taliban took over, after United States left and it took over, we find that they don't accept the Western democratic, liberal democratic values, equality, justice, freedom. They want Sharia to be the basis of the political system. So that's why we find that at this point of time, the status of women's right to education, because education is one of the main source of empowerment of women. Women gets educated, gets uplifted, gets employable, becomes center of power, so a decision maker. But then, you know, if she's not given these basic rights and she is confined to the four walls of the house and she has to act under certain cultural, limitations, which Taliban wants the society to operate in, we find that at this point of time, women, ever since Taliban has taken over, the situation is not rosy, because they say that the culturally, they're very different from the Western world. So I think that this is what I think that women, though they say at this point of time, they are saying that they will try to give this power, the right to educate or to be employable within the Islamic laws framework. But yet, we are not sure to what extent women will be able to enjoy this right. So this is what I think that so far Afghanistan is concerned. Women, so we have to look for some solution that there should be a kind of balance between cultural as well as liberal democratic values. Cultural values should also be protected, and liberal democratic values should also be. So human capital has to be developed, and women, because women constitute 50% of the society, and if any society deprives itself from the service of this 50% of the human resource, I think how society develops. So we have to give chance to women so that they operate to develop for the socioeconomic development of the country. They contribute significantly to the development of the country, then the country will develop and progress. So this is the liberal perception and the feminist perception that the women have to be, and it is the concern, it's not only feminists, that the women are feminists, even males are feminists, in the sense that women empowerment is the concern of all. If the world has to develop women, they have to fight for the cause of women empowerment. So I think that the war-like situation in Afghanistan is continues, civil war situation kind of, though with the use of power, with the aggressive force, they have controlled the political power. Taliban has controlled the political power. But people are not given the right to express their view for the formation of the political power. So here we find that the women are absolutely excluded from the political decision making. So it's very important that the war, if Pakistan continues to be in the warlike situation, it is doubtful that women would be able to enjoy the power, enjoy this power in the sense of self-development, and to be able to contribute to the development of the society and the nation. So this is what I think.
Thank you, ma'am. The next question is, how has the United States imperialism resulted in the Taliban taking control and the unrest we see today? Was this the right time for the US to leave Afghanistan, or was there ever a right time to leave?
You know, when we talk about imperialism, there are two viewpoints. One is the Marxist viewpoint, who considered imperialism as a tool of capitalism or expansion of capitalism to control other countries, others' territories, resources, people for the exploitation, for the economic benefits. But here, you know, there's another viewpoint. Here, United States didn't enter in Afghanistan for the purpose of economic exploitation. But when United States entered in Afghanistan after 2001 to fight against terrorism, its objective was social engineering to change the society of Afghanistan, to democratize it, to develop it, to introduce liberal democratic values, so that the society should be peaceful, and then it will be contributed to the world peace and security. But we find that this didn't happen. United States failed in its agenda, in its project of social engineering, because there is cultural difference. I told you that the people over there, you know, those who have been powerful forces, there are so many ethnic groups, and so many, they have differences among themselves, but they believe in Islamic values. So United States got indulged in counterinsurgency, mostly fighting against these kind of forces, and tried to, so it could not establish the democratic system, democratic values, or, you know, it couldn't help in the development of the
Ma'am, I believe your video is lacking.
Hello, I'm sorry, there was some problem with the internet connection. So I was just, can I continue? Yeah. So what I'm saying is that so for US states, after the Osama bin Laden was eliminated and Al-Qaeda was weakened or eliminated in a way, so that the US should withdraw from there, because that was the real objective of United States when it entered in Afghanistan, to fight war against terrorism or to eliminate them. But we find that so far this US is concerned, though it's Western imperialism is concerned, it's not in the sense, but USA could not, its objective was to eliminate terrorism. But then after 20 years, you just couldn't achieve its objective of social engineering. And I think even if it had continued for even next year, it wouldn't have been able to do it. So I think that only with the use of military forces or by the use of these kind of forces, the countries cannot duplicate situations where countries are different and different kind of political system. So I think that you would not establish peace despite staying there for 20 years. And we can compare the situation with Afghanistan, like it had to withdraw after 15 years. So partially we can see that it was not imperialism, but Westerners, Islamic perceived it as cultural imperialism that United States wanted. So US, they perceived US objective of social engineering as US hegemonic agenda, and they rejected it. And there had been constant war situation in Afghanistan.
The third question is, the Taliban claims that its government shall be inclusive and equal. How well do you think their current policies correspond to their international diplomatic stand on preserving women's rights in Afghanistan?
When Taliban came into power by the use of force and by committing all these atrocities, because there were so many groups of which were fighting for the control of political power. At that time, Taliban was rejected. It was not accepted or recognized by most of the countries in the world, particularly the Western countries in the world. Some of the countries are recognized, like Pakistan, China, and Iran and other countries, but most of the countries didn't. So here, that's why in order to get recognition from these countries, Taliban was making a point that it will have an inclusive government. But we find that the basic reason for this diplomatic stand of Taliban is that Taliban cannot do without the help of these Western countries. Because Western countries have a lot of projects, investments, companies in Afghanistan. And because of this violence, most of these companies are shut down, these projects are shut down, and people are out of jobs. So economically also, Afghanistan is collapsing. So if they have to bring Afghanistan's policy economy back to track, then they cannot do it without Western help. And that's why they are having this diplomatic stand that they will be observing this stand. They will be having the inclusive government. They will give chance to others also to be part of the government. Whereas we find, if you look at the structure of the government, these are all the Taliban-y structure has nothing to do with the inclusive. And so far the women are concerned, we find that women are absolutely excluded from the formation of the government, because culturally women cannot act in the public domain. So their education and their employability and all this are certainly affected. You don't find any women in the political system. So there's no coordination between what Talibanis are saying and what they are doing. This is just a diplomatic stand on the international forum to have recognition from the Western countries and to have financial support from these countries so that their economy should be on the rolls. So this is what I want to say about it.
The next question is, what steps of humanitarian assistance are being taken by the government of India? What will be the impact of Taliban takeover of Afghanistan for India economically, politically?
So far India is concerned, it always wanted to have stable Afghanistan, democratic Afghanistan, developed Afghanistan, because it is very important to have stable and peaceful Afghanistan for the regional peace and security. And that's why, India had started a lot of projects in Afghanistan, solar project, agrarian development projects, village projects, construction and development. So we were thinking of collaboration. We were thinking of having economic relationship with Afghanistan. It would have been mutually very, very beneficial to both the countries. But if I find out that so far Taliban is concerned, ever since it has come into power, it is violating the humanitarian, it is violating the human rights. And their human rights are violated. So countries, people are really suffering. So India has been extending, though it is maintaining a kind of balanced approach. It is trying to engage Taliban. It is not completely rejecting it. Though it is clearly, its stand is very clear that terrorism should not be promoted from there, and they should not use Afghanistan to promote terrorism in Afghanistan, in India. But at the same time, India wants to help the people of Afghanistan. So that's the reason that India had been exporting wheat, it had been exporting the medical equipments and medicines, etc., to Afghanistan. And recently also, we had been engaged in some of the talks, like there have been talks in Moscow, and we were involved in G20 talks, where we are very clear that we don't accept any undemocratic system, and we reject, there should be zero tolerance for terrorism. Any country from where terrorism is operated, or any country which is supporting terrorism in that particular country, they should be absolutely rejected, or, sanctions should be used against those countries. But at the same time, India is willing to support or extend humanitarian assistance for the people of Afghanistan. Because then this government is because democracy is government of the people, for the people, by the people. But here people are not asked in, they are not consulted, or their consent is not taken for the formation of this kind of political government. And people are rather victim of the atrocities, the situation, the warlike situation, or the civil war kind of situation in this country. So that's why India is willing to extend humanitarian assistance to the people of Afghanistan through international agencies or otherwise. On the ground that Afghanistan does not use its own homeland or its own territory to promote terrorism against India. So India is for inclusive government, India is for democratic government, India is for stable Afghanistan, India wants that the human capital in Afghanistan should be built, should be developed, because unless until human resources develop, the country cannot progress. So, thinking of people also change with education. So for development, it is very, very important to educate people, to make them employable. That will bring stability, that will bring peace, and that will eliminate these conflicting situations in Afghanistan. Yeah.
The next question is, how has the China-Pakistan nexus's open support for the Taliban further deteriorated the humanitarian conditions in Afghanistan?
As you know that these are the two neighboring countries of Afghanistan, China and Pakistan. Pakistan had a long association with Afghanistan. Pakistan had been instrumental in supporting terrorism in Afghanistan. And at the moment, even now, we see that this latest government is also, formulated by the intervention of Pakistan. Because Pakistan has never been interested in stable or peaceful Afghanistan, one for Pashtun reason, another for because they want to use Afghanistan against India. Pakistan's single agenda is destabilize India, or to create insecurity situations for India. So that's why Pakistan will be supporting terrorism in Afghanistan. And so where China is concerned, China, Pakistan, and Afghanistan nexus will be very, very dangerous for the regional peace and security. Because Afghanistan at this point of time needs economic help, reconstruction and development programs. And it looks forward to China's help for this purpose, because China has Belt Road Initiative in various countries, and China can do this in Afghanistan if it enters in collaboration with this. So Afghanistan is interested in China's help. But so far China is concerned, China wants to enter in Afghanistan for certain purposes. One, China wants to use Afghanistan against India. And secondly, China wants to control the 8 Earth's rare metals in Afghanistan. These are of trillions of dollars. China thinks that if it enters in Afghanistan, it can control these rare earth resources, metals, and it can use it for its economic purposes. And another reason is that China thinks that if it controls Afghanistan, it can also prevent the expansion of terrorism from Afghanistan to Chinese provinces, some of the provinces where the Islamic population is there. So I think that Pakistan, China have been had always adversarial relationship with India. And now if they promote terrorism in Afghanistan and the way they have recognized Afghanistan, that will be quite destabilizing for the region, and it will be very dangerous for the regional peace and security. So I think that China and Pakistan's nexus will be very, very dangerous for the regional peace and security.
The next question is, can organizations like us, that is non-government organizations, help in creating change for better observance of human rights, especially for women, by reaching out internationally to countries like Afghanistan? How can ordinary citizens help? Are there ways to contribute to the relief efforts besides sending money?
Yeah, I think that in certain situations, when national governments or international agencies fail to act directly or to deliver directly, then through non-governmental agencies, they can operate. Like an agency like yours, Girl Up, you know, this kind of NGOs, you know, UNO or other international agencies, when they support these kind of non-governmental agencies, which cut across the national boundaries and approach and they operate all over the world, they influence the international public opinion. They make people aware of the rights of women. They make people aware of the pathetic situation the women are in different countries, and they can build the international public opinion, and they can, you know, formulate. So this is how international public opinion can support the rights of women in different countries. So I think that NGOs have very important role to play. And these days, by the use of social media, because it is very easy. Earlier, NGOs were there, but they were not that effective. But in the contemporary world, by the use of social media, it is very easy to circulate ideas, to influence thinking, to build public opinion. And in situation of Afghanistan, as we have seen, that how all over the world there is a concern for the rights of people, the right of women. Yeah, so I think NGOs have to play a very, very important role to fight for the rights of women. And particularly, I congratulate the agency like yours, which is working. And apart from financial assistance, we can help, you know, the women empowerment by taking certain steps, which do not even interfere with their cultural, you know, domain. For instance, in the world of pandemic, as we have seen that online, we all are using online platforms. Even now I'm talking, you know, virtually. I'm educating the public opinion virtually. So if our university, Indian universities, try to educate Afghan women who are sitting at home through online education system, I think we can definitely help women to educate, to become empowered, and to become employable, to develop certain skills. And then there's a work from home culture, and then we can provide them jobs, you know, while they are working at home. So this way we can really help in empowering women by taking these kind of actions, because education, again, I emphasize, education is the one that empowers women, that eliminates any kind of differences between rich and poor, between girls and boys, and any kind of diversities. So I think that India has a lot to do. I mean, if we look at certain measures, you know, Afghan women produce certain things at home, and we help them to do online, you know, trade, business, or anything. So they can, circulate, or they can project their culture through certain commodities by trading their handicrafts or certain things like that. So we have to, try with these kind of ideas that how we can help the women of Afghanistan without interfering with cultural values. So that there's no objection, then they become empowered, they become employable, and that will help in building the healthy society as well. So this is where I think that we have to work on building the human capital. This is the human capital that can really reform the society, that can change the society, that can change the perspectives in the society.
Ma'am, the next question is, when the Taliban took over, world leaders were afraid of maintaining bilateral ties with a terrorist organization. How is the United Nations Human Rights Council dealing with this? What is the current stand of global leaders on the Taliban takeover of Afghanistan?
Yeah, when Taliban took over, as you know, that globally, most of the leaders had rejected this government as terrorist organization and which had violated the humanitarian rights. So at this point of time, they're trying to influence the thinking, because as I told you that Taliban needs Western help for economic development, and it wants its support and recognition. But the Western countries are maintaining a stand that they want to soften this Taliban's stand.
Really sorry, guys. I think ma'am is facing some technical difficulties. She'll be joining back.
मैम आ गया
तो उधर फिर प्रॉब्लम ही है ना.
I'm so sorry about this snag in the internet. So am I audible?
Yes.
Okay. So I was just saying that so far the international agencies are concerned, they are trying to work on the aspect of humanitarian relief because they want to really help the people of Afghanistan, and through various agencies like United Nations, you know, Human Rights Council, then they had G20, and through Moscow talks. Recently 10 countries had met in October, I think 21st October, and they decided to extend humanitarian relief to all these countries, to the people of Afghanistan. Their concern is that terrorism should be curbed, and there should be it should be democratized. But at the same time, they cannot completely disengage from Afghanistan. They have to keep Afghanistan engaged. They have to continue their talks with Taliban, and they have to take care of the interest of people. For instance, refugees in India. Also, we have seen that a lot of people had been, uplifted from Afghanistan, and all the people who became refugees in other countries, they're also they should be helped. So this is the concern of international community, that the people of Afghanistan should be helped. And they are taking several measures. So though they are not very, they are not enough, because at the moment we are in pandemic, we are in COVID. It is not easy to operate in this kind of situation. Most of the countries are struggling with their own problems. But still, international agencies are, trying to make people aware of the problem and trying to help the people of Afghanistan. Through various measures. Yeah.
Thank you so much, ma'am. The floor is now open for any further questions that the audience has. Please, you can either unmute yourself and ask, or you can type it in the chat box.
Any questions?
So I'll ask a question. Am I audible?
Yeah.
So there was this news that had come up, I believe, a month back, where there was this in Afghanistan, they were talking about how there will be a distinction of schools in, like, inside classrooms, that the boys will be sitting in one particular place, the girls will be sitting in one particular place. And there was this distinction that had come up. So I think that raised a lot of questions about the rights of women there. So can you comment a little about this news, and how, how we are facing, like, since our cause is also gender equality, and it is also women empowerment. So how we at an individual level, when we, the youth, and as socially aware citizens, as we are listening to all of these news stories, how can we help in any which way that it creates an impact?
Yeah, you are very much right. When United States had introduced these reforms of women education, because from 1995 onwards, when Taliban was there, there was hardly any women were not given the right to education or to work outside. But when United States introduced this right to education, the same teacher is teaching, but women are sitting in different room and males are sitting in different room. It is because of the cultural, they say that this is their culture, that the women have to sit in a separate space. And, it is difficult to interfere in any country's cultural or religious matters. So United States, so here we find that any country which is with Western democratic liberal values, like we are operating in our country also, there was a time when there was parda system. We used to, ladies used to wear veil and they were not allowed to, you know, so that kind of, but with education, this equality and freedom, these kind of things were created. Countries have been reforming with the change in the human capital. But in Afghanistan, we find that now women are not even allowed to go to for education outside for education. So I think online method, as I mentioned, that we can still educate women, you know, through online measures. Now these days, it doesn't matter who is listening to me, women or female or male or anyone. So the same teacher can teach. I think this online teaching is going to continue even after pandemic is over, because it has certain benefits. Sitting at home and you're doing much more than otherwise. Organizing a conference or a seminar was a huge work earlier. Having a space, transportation, time, traveling time and all these things. But now nationally and internationally, globally, you are connected. And, and it is so economical to have these kind of things. So in Afghanistan, as I said, that they are saying that it is against our culture. And it is difficult to touch their culture, and United States failed to do it. The social change, United States couldn't change the thinking of people of that country. So certainly this is a problem, but we have to look for the solutions that how we can still work for the women of that society. That they become empowered. Like, these days, online medication. So even if they become doctors, or if they become scientists, if they become educationists, if they become computer scientists by online education, most of us have done FDPs online, and we learned all these computer techniques, information technology through online means. So I think that there is a lot we can do in these, whatever we have learned in challenging times, we can apply these methods in countries like this. And we can still help in empowering women in countries like Afghanistan. With education, things will change. Because when women start contributing, people's perception towards women change. If women is contributing, if a woman is developed, she is doing good for the society, people look up to that woman. And this is how the perceptions change. So I think that this is the development of women that is going to change or reform the society. And we can do a lot in this respect, in this regard.
Ma'am, another question we have in the chat box from Nitya. How can ordinary citizens help?
Ordinary citizens can definitely help, because as I said, that NGOs, non-governmental organizations and social media, if they are making people aware, we should not feel, you should not just ignore. We should feel more concerned, and we should raise our voice for the rights of women. And we have to fight for our rights. It's not that it's not a cakewalk. People of our generation, we had to really work very hard, to come out in public domain, to start working. There were very few women who were allowed to do that, and we had to fight for our right. But these days it is, you are the very fortunate generation. But still, if you look at the whole of India, how many, what is the percentage of this kind of empowered women? So if we try to bring it to the grassroots level, it is going to reform the society. It is going to reform the country. So I think that ordinary citizens have a lot to do. They have to make themselves aware of the right that, what is the purpose of their life? What is the purpose of the life of women? You need to have a purpose in your life, and what you can do. I mean, you are not just born and to live, to get married, to have children, or to, just live. You have some responsibility towards this society, towards this country, towards this world. So if women all over the world have common cause, particularly women in the post-colonial societies, they are not that developed. So it is the responsibility, the country, the women of a country like India, they are much more liberal and democratic. So they have to make people of other countries aware through these NGOs. I remember when I had gone to Bagha border a couple of years ago, at that time on this side, the sitting capacity was almost more than 100%. On the other side, few people were women sitting, but not even a single woman was there. And here almost more than 50% people in the audience were women. And women were taking flag and they were running from the starting point to the border gate and showing the power of women, that how women are getting empowered. So people, women of countries like India, South Asian women, they are visible, their power is visible, their empowerment is visible. And it is their responsibility to extend helping hand to the women of rest of the countries, to make them aware that it is not anti-culture, it is not anti-religion, it is negative, rather it is going to be positive if they get empowered and they contribute to the society and the nation.
Ma'am, next question is from Kalpana. Afghani women ki problem solve karne mein media ki kya bhumika hai?
Media, as I said, that NGOs and media have to play a very important role and they can show. Otherwise, how we know? Earlier, it was difficult for people. Now, everybody is, even my maid servant is having a mobile. Every person is having a mobile and they can see anything. So anything comes up, people forward the information, and through media, it is not necessary to just to go through the news or to anything happens anywhere in any part of the world. The news is circulated very fast. So media plays very, very important role. This is how we know that how Afghan women is affected, and through media, though media is constrained in Afghanistan, in countries like those countries which are not democratic, the media is not very free to operate, but still media, whatever news we get, we just try to circulate it very fast in the democratic countries, and people can reflect on that.
Ma'am, the next question is from Shruti. When can we hope that the situation for women will get better in Afghanistan? Will international bodies play a role for doing so, or will they let Afghanistan on its own?
I know it is the common responsibility. If we leave Afghanistan on its own, the entire world will be in danger, not only Afghanistan women. It is not the cause of women of Afghanistan only, it is the cause of the security of the world. Because as we know that if international agencies do not work, if they do not provide the humanitarian assistance, if they do not support, then you know, women will be in pathetic condition. And so it is our moral responsibility, to work for the cause of women. International just cannot leave Afghanistan alone, and particularly India cannot leave Afghanistan, otherwise it fall in the lap of China. No agency but to restrain the behavior of these nations. So international agencies exert pressure on these countries, cannot have free hand in promoting terrorism and to suppress the rights of people. So international agencies have very important role to protect the rights of people, promote the democratic values in Afghanistan.
Good evening, ma'am. Thank you for such an insightful session. My question to you is that, like, with the coming of Taliban, like, how will the women activists and the organizations will be affected, like how they have been affected, and most importantly the funding aspect of these organizations will be impacted with the coming of Taliban?
You're talking about Afghanistan or all of the world?
Yes, ma'am.
Afghanistan. So you can imagine that women activists and all these agencies will definitely be affected, because the Taliban, it doesn't support. It talks about Sharia laws. It talks about this religious and cultural values. So they will definitely be suppressed in Afghanistan. So that's why it is the moral responsibility of international agencies and the NGOs like yours and the social media, journalists, and electronic and print media to make people aware, so that because you know these days difficult to live in a fragmented world. Any country cannot live in isolation, and Taliban also cannot live in isolation. But it can rely completely on Pakistan, China. It needs support of other countries as well for to bring its economy back to track. So that's why it is looking for the recognition and the economic help from the Western world and from other countries. Just trying to build diplomatic ties with these countries. So I think that gradually women conditions can definitely change with Asian. So if we continue, I mean, you have to have a multi-pronged strategy. Of course, these NGOs and all these activists are definitely under threat, but they have to be very, very bold. Then they have to spread education. It is not a one-day project. I mean, gradually the change will take place, but we cannot abandon, we cannot give up it completely. We have to continue efforts on several levels. For education, for employment, it's not activism that we want, right? I mean, it is activism for the empowerment of women, so that the women should be center of power in the sense that they are not completely dependent. They want to contribute to the society. They want to contribute to the building, nation building. They want to contribute to the.
So sorry, everyone. I think I'm stuck again. She'll be joining back really quick. For the time being, if you all have any questions, please put them in the chat box.
So many technical glitches, I'm sorry. any other question?
Yes, ma'am. The other question is by Reet. How can countries ensure that the women are safe in case a war ignites through their policies?
How women are safe in?
In case a war ignites through their policies.
How can women be safe in war-like situation? You know, it's difficult to say that because whenever there is war, it's not only women. Women suffer more, of course. Everybody suffers in war situation. And that's why women do not want war. I mean, if there are any policies, if countries are fighting for the right, for the survival or for the security, for the protection, then it's fine. So women can be feel safe if they become independent, if they are not dependent. If earlier, because the domains were divided, women were absolutely dependent on the male force in the family. So if the women are independent, they are self-reliant, they can take care of their families. then you know they can feel much better than you know than in the earlier situation when women were completely dependent.
I don't see any more questions in the chat box, so I believe that was it. I'd like to hand over to Nitya now.
Thank you so much. So as we come towards the end of this insightful and enriching session, I, Nitya Bhari, the president of Girl Up Neera, would like to propose the vote of thanks. First and foremost, on behalf of the entire Girl Up Neera, Girl Up Khwab, and Girl Up Now team, I would like to thank our speaker, Dr. Nirmal Jindal ma'am, for taking out the time to grace our session and making it a resounding success by giving her valuable inputs on the humanitarian crisis and the fate of women's rights in Afghanistan. I would also like to thank our audience that is gathered here today for joining the session. We value and appreciate your opinions and the questions raised by you on this issue. Last but not the least, I would like to thank Girl Up Khwab and Girl Up Now for collaborating with us and the members of all the three clubs that have been working day and night to ensure that this session is a success. It would not have been possible without you guys. Thank you, everyone, and we hope to see you in our next event.
Thank you very much. All right. Thank you very much. All right.